In a time when the cost of computer components are soaring, where tech executives seem increasingly driven by greed.
The more GPUs you buy, the more money you save.
And building a low-budget gaming rig with new parts feels like trying to snag a graphics card at MSRP in an expo full of scalpers. Will I be out of touch if I built an entry-level PC based on an 11-year-old platform combined with a server instead of a desktop CPU, and then trying to run modern games and applications on an operating system that shouldn't even work, all while using a graphics card that doesn't know what ray tracing is? Well, stick around, because I will discuss all of that. I will break down some of the hardware challenges I encountered, games that might need a special treat to run, and BIOS software limitations that might be a real deal breaker. Moreover, I will share with you potential solutions and alternative options, and by the end, I'll let you decide if this endeavor is worth the effort or is just a total waste of money. This box contains a used computer I recently purchased at a bargain, especially considering today's new and used PC market prices where I reside. For some reason, I was the only bidder, which I believe had something to do with the fact that the seller warned that there was some noise from the water cooling on the graphics card. The truth is, there are some potential risks associated with very old second-hand water cooling systems that can range from weird noises to catastrophic leaks. But honestly, the likelihood of an AI-liquid cooler leaking is about as likely as ending up butt-naked in a sketchy neighborhood at midnight trying to avoid the cold and stumbling into a Blue Oyster bar. I bet my ass that neither of these things are possible to happen, right? Still, I took the gamble along the risk of receiving a computer through courier. After a few nail-biting days, the package finally landed on my doorstep, but the excitement quickly turned into disbelief. The moment I opened it, screws rained down, and after a quick glance, I discovered that the rear PS2 and USB ports had completely detached from the input-output shield. Things didn't look good at all. Well, I guess things don't only look bad, they sound bad too. However, as my late grandpa used to say, you have to look the bright side of things. So this disaster turned out to be the perfect excuse to appropriately introduce all the PC parts of the system while taking everything apart for troubleshooting. This is the ASUS H97i Plus, a mini ATX motherboard that will host all the internal PC components. Sure, it's an 11-year-old platform with some aged DDR3 RAM and PCIe Express 3.0 slots, but it also comes with some up-to-date features like USB 3.0 ports, HDMI and DisplayPort outputs for a multi-monitor setup, and even an M.2 socket for blazing-fast NVMe storage. Plus, it has a special header that in theory will allow me to install an inexpensive TPM 2.0 module to bypass Microsoft's Windows 11 restrictions without resorting to any shading workarounds. If you are curious about the whole Windows 11 compatibility situation and Microsoft's controversial decision that leave millions of PCs vulnerable to malware or headed for the trash, then please check out my previous video. The link is in the description below. Anyways, after more thorough research, my plans hit a wall when I read ASUS TPM compatibility list and several people's failed attempts on such a task. Obviously, this setback wouldn't stop me from trying to install Windows 11. However, keep all of that in the back of your mind for future reference as we move on the Intel H97 chipset that powers this motherboard and does not offer any CPU overclocking capabilities to get a free boost from BIOS settings. But that's fine, because this CPU has a locked multiplier, so any attempt at overclocking will be a foolish errand anyway. Worth noting, this is an Intel Xeon processor designed for servers. However, I can install it on any desktop motherboard based on Intel's 9th Gen chipset, and there is no need for any BIOS updates or modifications of any kind. But this isn't exactly breaking news. Ever since the first generation of Intel's Core series, people have been installing affordable low-tier 4-core 8-thread Xeon CPUs in their desktops instead of spending their money on the pricier Core i7 counterparts. For obvious reasons, Intel didn't like that loophole, so with the release of the Skylake processors, Intel put an end to it. In fact, aside from one Broadwell Xeon, the Haswell architecture was the last where you could find a wide range of server processors that worked natively on a Socket 1155 motherboard. And this Xeon i3-1271v3, which I'm going to use on this build, has identical specs to Intel's top-tier locked i7 processor, except it doesn't have an integrated graphics unit and comes with a 50% price discount. With 4 cores and 8 threads, a turbo boost hitting 4 GHz, and a semi-decent IPC with up-to-scratch instruction sets, I expect this processor to meet at least the minimum of today's gaming demands. The only problem is that Microsoft once again decided to create unnecessary limitations, excluding this and many other CPUs from the Windows 11 compatibility list. So, in theory, I will not be able to install and run Windows 11 on the system without issues. However, we will find out soon enough if that is true. This motherboard supports up to 16 GB of system memory, which unfortunately is the bare minimum for gaming today. Moreover, the DDR3 memory is ancient compared to modern DDR5, and even a RAM overclocking won't magically make it perform like new. On the other hand, the M.2 socket on the back of the motherboard will host a high-speed storage drive for the operating system, while the eSATA ports will accommodate the devices for all the games and applications I will test today. There is even a mini PCIe slot in case I need to add Bluetooth or Wi-Fi. If you are wondering which graphics card I'm going to use, this is NVIDIA's GeForce GTX 1070, and unfortunately, it is also the source of the loud noise from the PC. Perhaps with one or two good shakes, I can remove the air bubbles trapped inside the card's pump. It would be a shame if that doesn't fix the issue, because this card was a mid to high tier beast back in 2016, playing anything at 1440p, and to this day it remains quite capable at handling games at 1080p on high settings, although it will struggle with anything featuring ray tracing. This PC came originally with a 550W power supply, but since I don't trust used PSUs I haven't personally vetted, I swapped it out for an inexpensive brand new Takens Radix Echo X 550W PSU, which provides a 6-year warranty, 10 circuit protections, all the necessary cables, and enough juice for our setup. Mention last but not least the 60mm Corsair AIO CPU liquid cooler from 2013 is still going strong, so I kept it, along with this used but scratched-free white NZXT mini yet spacious ITX tower, which surprisingly managed to house all the above internal components, even though it was a bit of a challenge of fitting everything together snugly. And now, with everything in place, the moment of truth. Well, it turns out I will need a different graphics card after all. So, I've decided to put the GTX 1070 and the old power supply unit up for sale to offset some of the cost of replacing it with this, a bit inferior but still somewhat capable for today's standards, AMD Radeon RX 570 with 8GB VRAM. On top of that, this card, along with every AMD's GPU made before RDNA series, has reduced driver support since 2023, which could lead to peculiar issues with games that came out afterward. But we'll just have to wait and see how it plays out. One more minor problem I had to manage was this USB-C connector, which is incompatible with the motherboard, so I purchased an inexpensive adapter to avoid having a dummy port on the PC case just staring at me like that. Here we are again, the moment of truth. This is one of those rare times when the beeps of an internal PC speaker sound like music to my ears. Now, all that's left is to tweak a few settings in the BIOS and try to install Windows 11. And look at that! Despite Microsoft's discouraging stance, this old PC runs Windows 11 just fine, with no slowdowns. Just a heads up! Microsoft's official statement is that if you install Windows 11 on unsupported hardware, they can't guarantee updates or security support. Moreover, they don't take any responsibility if your system malfunctions or your favorite games don't boot at all. So, So after installing Windows 11, I began the gaming benchmarks with a few esport live service games like Valorant. Everything seemed fine at first, but then my gameplay was interrupted by an error message saying that Vanguard, Riot Games' anti-cheat system, requires TPM version 2.0 to be enabled. I encountered the same exact problem when I tried to boot League of Legends. Unfortunately, none of the computer systems based on Intel's Kaby Lake or AMD's Zen architecture or earlier support TPM 2.0 natively or at all. On the bright side, there are plenty of alternatives for Riot Games' high-hat titles, like Dota 2, where our 4th-gen system performed quite well, even under the most intensifieds. At 1440p with FSR Ultra quality with low graphic settings, I've seen 88 average and 46 frames in 1% lows. As far as the first-person tactical hero shooter genre goes, there is a plethora of popular games to choose from. Let's start with Fortnite, which recently introduced a 5v5 tactical mode that might just satisfy your Valorant cravings, or you can just go full Battle Royale. No matter which game mode you pick in Fortnite, the combination of the Xeon 1271v3 and the RX 570 can deliver high frames per second with unbelievably smoothly frame pace for Fortnite at least, even under the more demanding DirectX 12 API, which provides better visual quality without the annoying stutters that plague both DirectX 11 and performance mode. And if Fortnite isn't your thing, you can always try Apex Legends. At 1080p with high textures and low on everything else, I had a buttery smooth gameplay with the average frames reaching the 112 and the 1% lows the 68. Next up is Counter-Strike 2. At 1440p with medium shadows and FSR quality mode, it averaged around 105fps with 1% lows touching the high 50s. Marvel Rivals, the most demanding of the bunch, required some time to fine-tune it. The end result was a mixture of graphics settings ranging from low to ultra based on what the RX 570 could handle at 1080 resolution with TAAU scaling set at 70%. Despite the effort, a solid average of 60 and a meager 31% lows was the most I could squeeze out of it. Of course, beyond esports, I also had to throw in a couple of popular classics like Minecraft the Java Edition, which runs smoothly at 1080p with 12 chunks, fancy graphics, and the sodium mode enabled. It delivered a ton of frames on average, though as usual, the 1% lows nosedived at 79, mainly due to the initial frame drops while the game engine was still rendering the world. GTA 5 also impressed with solid performance at 1080p, everything set to high, averaging 101fps with 1% lows at 70. This highlights that our ring can easily run older DirectX 11 titles very smoothly, which is something one would naturally expect from a same-age computer. What is not expected, though, is running or even booting some of the most recent heavy-duty games like Baldur's Gate 3. Whether it was the GPU-heavy early acts or the more CPU-intensive lower seat area in Act 3, the frame rate stayed pretty consistent, with only occasional drops during cinematic scenes. At 1440p high graphics settings and FSR set to quality, the 36 average and 23 lows might not sound like much, but it's definitely more than enough for a turn-based RPG. The benchmark for Black Myth Wukong at 1080p using a mix of high and medium settings and FSR scaling at 86% displayed some visual stunning scenes. However, I must admit that the water reflections looked like a bit of gelatin. Beyond that, there were moments of irregular motion that made the camera movement feel jerky, despite the fact that the overall frames never dropped below the 30s, and I was also capturing the footage at 30fps while using a FreeSync monitor. More or less, I got similar results playing Elden Ring at 1080 resolution on high-medium settings, with the Riva Tuner capturing 47 and 35 frames on average and 1% lows respectively. Again, there were moments of skittering that neither monitor's FreeSync nor AMD's enhanced sync could resolve, which made it clear that in these high action games, an FPS limiter will definitely help. Cyberpunk 2077 also highlighted this same screen tearing issue. At 1080p with high medium settings and FSR enabled at 50% sharpening, the frame rates range between 55 and 35 and never dropping below the 30s, even during the most intense scenes. Obviously, this can easily be fixed with a frame limiter, but there are other problems that can be resolved, like the random flickering across the entire screen when running the integrated benchmark of Monster Hunter Wilds. I tried adjusting all the in-game settings, but nothing worked. So I'm guessing this monstrosity is either a bug or something related to the hardware limitations of our unsupported graphics card. One more pressing issue is that the RX 570, or any GPU that can handle ray tracing feature, will have to cope with yet another challenge, which is the mandatory ray tracing that some big gaming studios are lately pushing. Naturally, like any aging system, this 4th-gen Intel PC will eventually struggle to run future games. However, I wouldn't worry too much about it, as it can still be transformed into a fantastic retro machine that can emulate a broad range of consoles. Just keep in mind that heavier emulators like the RPC S3 won't run well because our Xeon can handle AVX 512 instructions. That said, anything lighter than that will run perfectly fine with reasonable graphic settings. As always, like to say, a computer isn't just for gaming. This system is capable of handling a wide range of tasks, including video and audio editing, CAD modeling, programming, and rendering. While it won't be as fast as the latest high-end computers, it can still perform many of the same tasks, just at a slower speed. That, at least, was what I concluded after reviewing the results from the productivity and synthetic benchmarks. On top of that, it does all this while consuming less than 265 Watt at full load. The thermals are also pretty good, with an ambient temperature of 21 degrees Celsius, and during intense gaming, the single-fan GPU ranged between 75 and 83 degrees, while the CPU stayed comfortably below the 60. It just goes to show that when an old AIO liquid cooler works, it really works. Overall, I didn't expect this 2016 PC to perform as well as it did in my tests. Even though it's built on Intel's 4th-gen platform, running on a i3-7021 V3 Xeon, which caused some bottlenecks in certain games, along with a few hardware restrictions like the outdated but still adequate 16GB DDR3 RAM or the RX 570 with a limited driver support, despite all that, its raw power is still more than enough to handle recent free-to-play and live service games at 1080p on high settings, delivering solid frames per second. As for modern AAA titles, AMD's Fidelity Super Resolution, paired with a 30fps limiter, will be just enough to provide an enjoyable gameplay experience without having to splurge on expensive new hardware. And if it weren't for that motor issue in the water pump of the VGA GTX 1070 Hybrid, this $200 gaming rig would have performed a lot better. But that's the risk you take when building computers with used parts. Sometimes you get lucky, and sometimes you don't. Which makes me wonder, do you still rock on an Intel Haswell processor? And what graphics card are you pairing with? Let me know in the comments, along with your thoughts on the other topics discussed in this video. And since you are still watching, here's more of my YouTube content that might interest you.